Howdy! Love is Blind Season 3, Dallas version, and I'm going all in. In this video, I want to talk about each of the cast. Who are they in terms of their attachment style, and who do I think is ready for love? Make sure you subscribe to my channel. Welcome to Reality TV Therapy with me, Dr. Diane. Welcome back. If you're new to my channel, Reality TV Therapy, I want to welcome you. I'm Dr. Diane, your host. I'm a psychologist and a relationship expert. I do couples therapy and I help people find love. But I use reality dating shows like Love is Blind looking for the lessons that we can learn in love. What can we learn from dating and in our relationships? And in all of my videos, I do what's called a reality check. I've got this cute little mirror here because I want you to learn something from these shows. What's the takeaway for you to apply to yourself? In this first video, Love is Blind Season 3, I want to talk about what each of the cast attachment style is. I have lots of other videos about attachment theory, but I want to talk about the four main attachment styles. Number one, you can be securely attached. This is the optimal way to be. This would be if you came from a good family and you know how to trust other people because you had consistent caregivers. This is going to look like a trusting person in relationships and someone who has good communication styles. But number two, if you're not securely attached, you're going to be insecure. The first type would be somebody who's anxiously ambivalent. I call them somebody who's a nervous Nora or a nervous Nick. Why nervous? Because there's a nervous energy around relationships. You experienced a caregiver, either your mother or father or both. They were there for you sometimes, but not others. So in your romantic relationships, you're going to be a little bit ambivalent. You are attracted to love, but at the same time, you don't fully trust your partner. Think about who that might be. The third type of person is someone who we call anxious avoidant. I call that person independent because they don't want to lose their independence. That would be an independent Isabel or Ian type. Now, this person is afraid of being vulnerable and they might push people off, being a bit picky or difficult, and they fear conflict. Who might that be? Then the fourth type is someone who's called fearful avoidant. It's a combination of both. Usually this person has suffered some abuse in their life, severe neglect. I would call them a confused Connie or Connor. It's more rare, thankfully, and it would be hard for me to predict because I don't know these people's family history. Now, what is important is to recognize that I call myself a media psychologist. What does that mean? I'm making suppositions here. None of these people are my clients, but I'm looking at behaviors. I'm looking at what can we understand based upon what they're doing. Because it's not just looking on the surface, who is this person? It's looking deeper. What is driving the insecurity and where would they need to move into? Because the great thing about attachment theory, it's one of the best theories around to describe relationships, but we can move from an insecure type more towards a secure type. That's what we all want, right? And the point is to find a good partner, not necessarily that we have everything in common, but they can partner to us in such a way that we can start to feel more secure with this person. Because love isn't blind, it has to be secure. So I would say love is secure. All right, so let's dive in. I want to go one by each of these women and describe who I think this person is. Again, I have limited information, but we can also glean a bit about this. And I've been a psychologist for 20 plus years, so I have seen hundreds of people, thousands of people online I've helped to understand what category someone goes into. Remember, it's helpful information. Let's start with Raven. Who is Raven? She's 27 years old. She's a Pilates instructor. And we even see her teaching the women Pilates. Now, what do we know about Raven? Well, she hits it off in the pods with Bartice. And she got a lot of flack from people because we saw her exercising in the pods. It looks like Raven obviously cares a lot about her body and about fitness. But what I found fascinating about this interaction, and again, I think Bartice and her are actually quite similar in that they both love fitness, but it looked to me that Raven was a little bit bored. She's listening to Bartice talk about his situation, but maybe like she's heard this before. Now, I'm not suggesting that this is the right thing to do. In fact, I did an earlier video saying what not to do, not to be distracted while someone's sharing something important about themselves. But I do think that Raven is, Bartice at least, is bringing out something that might be familiar to her with other partners. And she knows, yeah, I know guys like you otherwise. And so what happened was she checked out. And as she did that, she just went into her routine and she didn't think that he could hear her. It was a bad look on Raven, but I do think that Raven is there because she's looking for something different. And we'll get to that when we talk to, about her and Eske. But who is Raven otherwise? Well, I sense that she has the energy of an independent Isabel type. What do I mean by that? Why do I say that? Well, what are the clues? Well, in the pool, when we see Bartice and Raven, she says, like, I don't approach people, right? She gives off a very cool kind of unavailable vibe. People like independent Isabels, like I think Raven is, can give off a cool demeanor like, I don't care that much. You're not going to get much affection or attention from me. And they can be very picky. Underneath, they really fear conflict because they don't want to be vulnerable and they don't want to lose their independence. But Raven can't help herself. We even see this with her in Eske. She's a teacher. She can't help but coach and teach. And I think there's a way that she's hiding and she doesn't truly know how to be vulnerable. So if I was Raven's therapist, I would really be encouraging Raven to not talk about the superficial, to not talk about the Nancys and how she thinks that, you know, Nancy is too agreeable, but I would really encourage Raven to go deeper because if she wants a long-standing committing relationship, it's not just about lifestyle. It's about what will you share, Raven? Those are my thoughts about her. Next, let's talk about Colleen. Now, Colleen to me feels a little bit young. She's only 25. She's a ballet dancer and she's leading with being a ballet dancer. We know that this is very important to her, but she is bubbly, right? She's kind and she admits that she gets hurt easily. She really cares very much what people think about her. She's quite different from Raven because she cares so much what people think about her. To me, Colleen has the energy of more of an anxious type. I would call her a nervous Nora type because she's very much attuned to other people, very much a people pleaser. Brennan, for instance, says he's no longer available because he's interested in Alexa. We hear from Cole that she's too shallow. And this does bother her. How could it not? Colleen does seem interested, though, in continuing to try, which does impress me. But I feel like there's a lot of place for growth for Colleen. I actually have some hope for her. But these are the remnant factors of having an anxious attachment style. You could be a people pleaser. And with someone like Matt, you can see that she's flattered by him, but maybe she's not putting enough boundaries there. And so that's going to be my worry for her for the future. Now, she also can't help but someone like Cole, for instance, right? He rejected her. He said, you're too shallow. But then when he asks her in the pool, hey, are you mad at me? She thinks she has to be too nice. What she could have said, if she was more secure, she could have said, yeah, you know what? Cole, you rejected me, and the truth is, I don't think you're my type of person because, yes, we might have been attracted to a people in the real world, but that's not the type of person who works for me now. And I feel like Colleen's ego got a little bit too involved here. So if I was Colleen's therapist, what would I want for her? I would want her to feel more confident and to be able to push back when she got information that didn't fit for her, to actually call her partner out on that. That would be more secure, more what a secure Sophia would do. So I would really want to encourage Colleen to work on not pleasing so much, not being so agreeable, and setting better boundaries. Next, we have Zanab. They call her Z. She's a 28-year-old flight attendant. She's unapologetically picky as F. And she realizes that she's going to need to get over that. But she is a bit worldly. She's traveled a lot. And she's lost her parents, though. This does not get lost on me. I start thinking about, who is this young woman? She has some wounds from childhood. She lost her father. He died in a heart attack. And then she lost her mother after that. So I think about her and think, wow, that must be tough to be a young woman in the world. But she's a godly person. And she does seem like she's kind of got it together. Now, like Colleen, though, her energy feels anxious to me, that she takes things very personally. For instance, we see her the night after that she's with Cole. She can't help but take that very hurt. And she comes about it in such a way that she's not able to kind of talk through her hurt. So I worry about Zanab in terms of her communication styles. Now, I think that she's attracted to Cole because they do have some nice things in common. But she does have some rejection issues that I think are going to come up and are going to become problematic. Now, Cole, and I'm going to get to him, calls her passive aggressive. I don't think he's using that term correctly. But she does need a man who's going to partner to her in more of a secure functioning way. Because, let's face it though, I don't think there's a ton of men in this season to choose from. But I do think that Z needs to stay true to herself. Because what we saw in the pods is she's a spiritual person. She says, you know, I found myself praying for you. And I think that was a big attraction. But I'd hope for Z that she will also find more confidence and will look less for validation. There's too much comparing she does in her head, and it makes her feel insecure. And I want to say, Z, you're a beautiful woman. Please stop comparing yourself to other people and hopefully find some confidence in this process. Now, Alexa, let's talk about who she is. She's slightly older. She's 29. She is an insurance agency owner. She seems very confident. She says, I love me and I love eating. I love being confident. I love my Israeli culture. She's very attached to her family and she does want to get married. Now, she also appreciates that she's not for everyone. Like she swears, she's really into fashion. And I really get a sense that she genuinely likes herself. Now, what's fascinating to me, and even their host, Vanessa Lachey, says that oftentimes larger, curvy girls don't go very far on Love is Blind, even though they do cast people with body diversity for this very issue, that they're not confident enough and something gets translated in the pods where they don't get chosen. But Alexa is opposite of that. Again, she has a sense that I don't really care that much, and that's what we have to love about her, that she does feel like she has expectations of what she wants. And when we meet her family, I think we get a very interesting snapshot, because the family to me felt a little bit like the Kardashians, right? And so I'm hopeful that Alexa to me feels pretty secure. Her dad seems like he's very down to earth, the fact that they have a lot. But I hope that Alexa can receive the love that Brennan's going to give her. All right, and finally, let's talk about Nancy. Nancy is 31 years old. She's a speech pathologist, but she also is a real estate investor. I think Nancy's really got it together. Now, I do think that she has more of an anxious attachment style energy. Why do I say that? Because it's like 17 minutes in and Nancy's crying. She really cares. I'm not sure if it's about her age, but there's some hurt here that I get a sense. And that she really does want a relationship, though. I feel like she is all in it, a little bit like Brennan is. But she is certainly eager. And she wants to be transparent. She tells Bartice in the pods that she was an egg donor, that there are technically up to 100 little Nancys out there. She wants to be transparent. And she also wants a better life. But we see when she's choosing between Andrew and Bartice that she goes for the warmth. Because yes, she does want a nicer life, and I think she's attracted to Andrew for that reason, but she really knows that she needs a loving partner. And I'm going to get to Bartice, but I think she thought that she was getting somebody other than what she got. Now, again, I would want Nancy to be able to filter in what somebody says versus what they do. Because here is where an anxious person gives their partner too many benefits of the doubt, and she's not secure enough to push back to Bartice and say, hey, I don't like that. Hey, you got to take a look at how this affects me. I feel like she's a little bit like Colleen in that way, a bit too much of a people pleaser. And I want Nancy to have more confidence. All right, let's talk about the men. Let's lead with Brennan. Brennan reminds me of Cameron from season one, Love is Blind. What do you think? Let me know in the comments. He seems like he's got it together, right? He seems like he got the assignment right. Brennan with his big Texas hat, he's all in because he does know that love is blind. And I really think Brennan got the memo. Date somebody who's different than what you've done before, right? They all come to this experiment because they have struggled because love is not blind. And your looks either work for you or against you. But Brennan seems like he's someone who's just really ready. He's confident and all the women agree. He's a foodie. He loves big family. He's down to earth. He's kind of a good old boy. But he has not come from a lot. He said that he grew up and they didn't have heat. They didn't have other things. So he really, to me, feels like a self-made man. And he's not afraid to get vulnerable, but he is a big personality. And I just get the sense that he, given his readiness, that he's ready to be all in. And he asks the question, is love blind? He says 100%, absolutely. But he's excited to get going. We'll see what happens with him and Alexa. Okay. And what I did really like about Brennan too is that when he decided that he was all in on Alexa, he let the other women go. And I think that was a really secure move. So I do think that Brennan comes from a secure functioning family, and we'll see how that plays out. Let's talk about SK. I think SK is a fascinating person. He's 34 years old. He's a data engineer. He's from Nigeria, and he gives off, I don't know, methodical kind of energy. He seems very rational, a little bit intense. Now, the problem is he's going to UC Berkeley in the fall for graduate school. He's 34 years old, but he's getting a master's degree at the Haas Business School. I know this because it's right down the street from me. And I wondered if the timing was really right. So for me, it feels like, ooh, that's a lot to ask a new partner to do long distance. But he is clear he wants an educated wife who isn't ignorant, and he does seem very rooted in his culture. We get to meet his family. They're very much into the Nigerian way, but that seems very accepting and open. And I think he's kind of tossed between two worlds, his Nigerian background and wanting to have a more modern life. Let's talk about Matt. He's a 28 years old. He's a private sales manager. Feels a little bit salesy to me, but he does look at least like he comes from a nice, loving family. Now, what we learn about Matt in the pods is that he was previously married. This is a big part of his story, that he was married to his high school sweetheart. I thought I read from 18 to 24, so he's had a few years post-divorce. But what feels to me like undone and needs to be healed here, for me at least, is that his wife cheated on him and then got pregnant by the other man. That this, while it's touching, it doesn't feel like he has put this to rest. Now, as the episodes move on, I'm a bit worried actually about Matt and Colleen. To me, Matt feels like he does have some what I call nervous Nick, anxious, ambivalent kind of energy. He needs a lot of reassurance. But as the episodes go on, I'm also worried that he might be a bit controlling. And because this trust issue is still out there, I don't know if it's from childhood or from this last relationship, it sounds like he can get pretty quickly upset with Colleen, and that's what scares me, right? Because he comes on very strong, and she's very good, and she's kind of stroking him, but he needs more of this, and I worry about that. I worry about his issues of jealousy. And is he going to be someone who is going to be able to calm down enough to really be a good partner for Colleen? So I'm watching this connection, and I'm going to talk about the couples specifically. Let's talk about Bertice. Bertice is 26, or it says 27, that he's a senior analyst, but he's really kind of a fitness and nutrition guy. All the other women think he's very charismatic. He's logical. And here's what I think about Bertice. I think that Bertice, to me, feels like he has more of an avoidant flavor. I don't think he's actually really good at being vulnerable, but I feel like he came into this experiment saying, I'm going to be somebody different than who I am. And this is the problem, because people like that can serve to blindside other partners. So I think he came in and said to himself, I'm going to be open. I'm going to be kind. I'm going to be understanding, right? To Nancy, he says, oh, I think that's wonderful that you donated your eggs. To Raven, he says, oh, if I was your guy, I would be very secure about this. But I don't know if that's something he can really pull off, because again, I feel like he's more this independent Ian type, that he likes to do his own thing, and he hasn't really dealt with conflict. And there's, as time goes on, I'm seeing more critical parts of Bertice, right? He was quick to cut Raven off. Oh, how dare you be working out while I'm talking? And I get that. That was tough, but that felt harsh. And he wants to convince himself that love is blind. But boom, in real life, he goes right back to who he was. He does care very much about looks. And here's the thing that just felt really insensitive to me. He says to Nancy, like they're best friends, he's just processing without filtering what he thinks about Raven and how she's a smoke show and attracted. These are not good communication skills. This is, to me, is not a secure functioning partner who can really filter that out. I don't see a lot of insight, and that's what worries me. And then when Nancy's going on and explaining about her previous partner and her real estate deals, instead of leaning into that and saying, wow, I'm really proud of you for doing that, he sees it as her somehow withholding. And then with the family leaning into that, I don't feel like he really showed up for her. So that's Bertice. I think he has more of that independent Ian flavor, and he's going to need to work on really digging deep to be more vulnerable. All right, let's talk about Cole. Now, Cole is a 26-year-old real estate flipper. But for a flipper who flips homes, he's living in a crappy apartment, and things like this don't fit up for me. So it's like he feels a bit like a frat boy, and if you look at his Instagram page, he's really into the outdoors and paddleboarding and family and God. But he feels to me like a mix of Barnett with Shane, and I'm just not sure if he even knows who he is. So he says, and he presents to Zabe, that he's this big loving family, but then it's the same family who doesn't believe in this experiment, and they're not going to show up for him. So the thing that worries me about Cole is that he did marry someone after knowing them for only 2 months. So one could say, well, love is blind is not a big jump for him. But then he was divorced only 4 months later. So that to me feels like a nervous wanting so badly to be in a relationship, but not having the skills to communicate through conflict again. So I felt like that's concerning. That also, like Bertice, he doesn't have a filter. He's talking to Zanab about Colleen without paying attention how that would hurt her. So that felt like a lot of nervous energy for me. And two nervous people together can have their share of problems. All right. Let's talk about Andrew. Andrew was not partnered at this point, but he's coming back into the series, so I think it's important. Now, he to me seemed more elusive. Like, who is this man? He's a man of mystery. There's something about Andrew that we just don't understand. He clearly has lots of stories. He's a wildlife photographer. He's been to Germany, Istanbul, Kenya. He's intelligent, but he's leading with what to me feels like a lot of narcissistic energy. I'm not calling him a narcissist because I don't know him, but is he really talking about relationships? Because this is bragging about what he's done as opposed to talking about who he is. And he's talking about, you know, transcendental sexual experiences where that just felt too personal to me. And, you know, of course it's going to be provocative to the women because it's erotic. But where do we go with that, Andrew? And that to me felt like leading with too much sexuality. So I worry about his pacing. I worry about his ability to really stay put. And he feels to me kind of like a caricature created by Elon Musk. And I think the fake tears to me were just really too much. And I think he thought that production was going to save him and that they were going to use it in a positive way. But we also know this is a show about drama and you never let your guard down or trust that production won't use that against you. But we're going to see more about Andrew and I'll say more about him then. So those are the top characters that we're going to see in the couples. In my next video, I'm going to talk about who they are as couples, like what type of pairing that goes together or not. But there were plenty of other people we just didn't get to learn more about them. But I want to land with a reality check. What can we learn from these beginning episodes of Love is Blind Season 3? Well, if you want to get married, marry someone who wants to be married. Okay, I want to repeat that again. Marry someone who wants to be married. Why? Because if a man says, or a woman, that they're not ready, but they're ready with you, what does that mean? That means that they're leading with so much pressure and specificity. That means that I'm not interested in being married, but I will marry you because you're perfect. Then that means if you're no longer perfect, they're not interested in being married anymore. And this to me feels like such a loaded expectation. So the people that I think, in summary, who are more interested in being married are the Brennans of the world, who said that looks don't matter that much. I also feel that Nancy's very much interested in it and interested for the right reasons. But some of our other characters, you have to look a little bit deeper. What are they interested? Are they willing to be negotiable? Can they commit? And I've got more to say in my next video. Stay tuned.